Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, please stand for the Pledge of Allegiance and remain standing for the singing of the first verse of the National Anthem. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. The President of the University.
Mr. Rector, members of the Board of Visitors, ladies and gentlemen, and especially you members of the class of 2017. Welcome to the end of the 188th academic session. These exercises are the university's most joyous occasion when we gather to award degrees and to celebrate the achievements of the graduating class. Today, we are conferring degrees on the graduates from the College and Graduate School of Arts and Sciences. Tomorrow, we will confer degrees on the candidates from the university's 10 other schools and the Data Science Institute. I should acknowledge that we are celebrating this weekend's final exercises without some of our student athletes. The men's baseball team is playing at Georgia Tech. The men's tennis team is playing in the NCAA quarterfinals. And we wish them luck. Our music today is provided by the 392nd Army Band from Fort Lee, Virginia. They are under the direction of Chief Warrant Officer 2 Kevin L. Pick, and please give them and the Army, Navy, and Air Force ROTC students who presented the colors some appreciation. Today's ceremony is a celebration of the efforts of entire families, as well as the individual students. For parents whose sons and daughters receive degrees today, we acknowledge your commitments that began long before your students came to study here. Our admiration extends to grandparents, aunts, uncles, other family members who encouraged these men and women in their academic careers. We recognize the spouses and children of some of our students who made sacrifices and offered encouragement to make this day possible. Students, would you please join me in a round of applause for your families? These final exercises also celebrate the contributions of our teaching, research, and support faculty, and the staff members who work in many different occupations across the grounds. Each diploma symbolizes the vitality of our faculty's endeavors, their passion for learning, their efforts to engage students in intellectual discourse, their ability to inspire the pursuit of knowledge. Staff members provide critical support for the academic enterprise. Students, please join me in a round of applause for the faculty and staff who guided and supported. Of course, the greatest accomplishment belongs to those of you who earn your degree today. You have committed yourselves to a set of values that define this university. Academic excellence, honor, service, inclusion, leadership, and accountability for yourself and for your peers. You have lived what you have learned. The knowledge and habits of mind that you have acquired at the University of Virginia will become your tools for leadership in the world to which you go.
The rector of the university.
I'm just going to make a few comments before I introduce our speaker, but first of all, we really got to thank the good weather we have, because it is not only a breeze, it's not too hot, so we thank you. And for you graduates, I'd like to offer my personal congratulations. I sort of hesitate to do this, but I could almost pick out the student underneath that tree right over there, because that's where I sat about 51 years ago when I got my degree here. So it was cool that day, and the tree was nice. I also want to echo a couple things that Terry said. We got great students here. This is by far the greatest fantastic university. When I read things, and I don't know, I'm not going to get into the media controversy, but I think they just love to pick on us sometimes. And I can tell you from being around here, it is a great, great university, and we will get even better. Also, I think you graduates would hopefully go along with me. We have a fantastic faculty in all of our departments. We've got a great staff. Many of them are up here and some are down. And of course, we got a great leader in President Sullivan. And I'd love to thank President Sullivan, her staff, and the faculty. Now, we're fortunate to have a great speaker today, and I'm going to try to do her justice in her introduction, and hopefully I will. But it is my distinct honor to introduce our keynote speaker for today, a lover of literature, dedicated to mentor to her students, and a passionate seeker of truth. Deborah McDowell has enhanced our community, touched our hearts, and she is a director of the Carter G. Woodson Institute of African American and African Studies and the Alice Griffin Professor of Literary Studies. That's a lot right there, so she should be real proud. Among many other accomplishments, she founded the African American Woman Writers Series at Beacon Press, where she worked as an editor, and she also co-authored several books. Her immense catalog of publications include, among other things, The Change in Same, Black Women's Literature, Criticism and Theory, and Leaving Pipe Shope Memories of Ken, a memory of her childhood in Alabama. Ms. Dow also featured in Unearthed and Understood, a documentary produced by the President's Commission on Slavery. She is also an alumna of Tuskegee University and Purdue University, and she's held several associate professorships before joining us at the University of Virginia in 1987. So please, let's welcome her, and thank you very much, Deborah, for joining us.
Good morning. President Sullivan, Mr. Rector, members of the Board of Visitors, Vice Presidents, Deans, members of the faculty, my colleagues, honored guests, and not least, the families and friends of the graduating class of 2017. Before I proceed with my remarks, I want to elaborate, echoing Terry, on these opening acknowledgments. For no one reaches this occasion without the assistance and support of many, many people. I know, without knowing your names, the sacrifices you have made, the anxieties you have endured, the hopes you have sustained, the encouragement you have showered on these our graduates who sit proudly before us, ready to leave us to commence the next stage of their journeys. First, let me acknowledge and applaud the mothers and fathers, grandparents, aunts and uncles, neighbors, friends, step-parents, brothers, sisters, professors, boos and ex-boos and wannabe boos, the whole kit and caboodle. Happily, we have now reached that stage in our development as a species when we define kin in multiple ways. So if I have missed any categories, shout them out now. However we define kin, whether traditional or non-traditional, we know that without their support, so many of our efforts would have run aground. So another round of applause for you. I am humbled, honored, and privileged to have been invited to address you on so momentous an occasion. And I want to begin with a confession. As soon as I accepted this invitation, fear and dread set in. After all, speaking at commencement can be a fraught affair. Students and faculty can reject a speaker before she ever sets pen to page. And if she manages to overcome the outcry, the opposition and petitions, and actually steps up to the podium, the members of the audience can turn their backs, drowning out the speech with hisses, boos, and bullhorns. At least as far as I know, no one objected to my standing here today. But that fact has done nothing to allay my anxieties in the lead up to this occasion. Literally every day since receiving this invitation, one question has been nagging me. What could I possibly say to you that hadn't already been said? And by my oratorical betters, what could I say, particularly in these desponding times, that would not cast a pall over the celebration? No joke. I have literally been sweating and fretting and pacing the floor of my study for several weeks, snapping all too often at two innocent little children who were simply dying to know when I would be finally finished with that speech so we could resume our weekly at-home talent shows featuring my niece dancing the Kwan, my nephew singing James Brown, he has mastered the scream, and me joining in as Maceo. As a literary scholar, I am naturally a student of genre and audience, and thus I know that even when certain generic conventions shift and evolve with the times, others abide, including those centuries-old conventions defining the commencement address. Immemorially, commencement speakers have been expected to discharge their function as seasonal sources of sage advice dispensed in digestible nuggets, preferably sweet nuggets. Those of you who may have taken my classes or colleagues who have had to listen to me drone on in various meetings know that I am singularly incapable of delivering anything in digestible nuggets, and certainly not sweet ones. Why am I sharing this information, you are surely asking by now? Should it be regarded in these times as seemly oversharing? I do so for two reasons. One, from time to time, it helps to demystify authority figures, especially professors, to chunk them down a bit in your imaginations where many live rent-free as bloated superegos, dogging your every step and effort. Two, in an aggressively product-oriented society, we don't leave much time to recognize, honor, or accept the realities and uncertainties of process, of gestation. As students about to leave these hallowed grounds, I am sure you have found yourselves lamenting how little time you actually have to process the wealth of information you take in from day to day, from course to course, for the next 5-page, 10-page paper or honors thesis is breathing down your neck. In honor of process, then, I've chosen to invite you in to share with you selected stages in the making of this address. In other words, I invite you to listen to my narrative of the stages before the stage. Stage one. Returning to the question, what can I say? What should I say? I come from a people who believe in the idea and power of ancestors. And thus, as I continued to pace and fret, I was not at all surprised to be visited by the late African-American poet and essayist Audre Lorde, who gave me a clear directive, go back and read my essay, The Transformation of Silence into Language and Action. I read aloud a frequently excerpted passage. What is most important to me must be spoken, made verbal, and shared, even at the risk of having it bruised and misunderstood. And then came the familiar, always arresting question of that essay. What are the words you do not yet have? What do you need to say? What are the tyrannies you swallow day by day and attempt to make your own? I closed the book. I could not answer. And in this moment of avoidance, I resorted to that tried, true, and sanctioned response of a scholar to a question she is not yet ready to answer. Keep reading. Keep researching. And so I began to read commencement addresses. Among the dozens I have read or listened to since accepting this invitation, I have discovered one common denominator. With few exceptions, the speaker proceeds from the particulars of place, from her or his specific location or vocation. Actors speak about acting, musicians music, comedians comedy, politicians politics, physicians, patients, preachers, preaching. Although when Ralph Waldo Emerson delivered the Divinity School address at the Harvard Divinity School in 1838, among the most famous in the annals of commencement speeches, he had renounced his vocation as a preacher, That fact did not deter him from railing against preachers categorically. His address to a tiny class of 6 students, together with their families, friends, and teachers, was anything but sweet. The speech created such consternation that Emerson was immediately branded an apostate and subsequently banished from Harvard for nearly 30 years thereafter. As my speech today comes near the end of my almost 30-year tenure at this university, perhaps I can be indulged, no matter what I say here, and allowed to ride out at UVA the few remaining years I hope to claim membership in the professoriate. And it is from this humble vocation that I speak to you this morning, practicing some tools of my training, framing, supplementing, reading text close up, but also challenging interpretive complacencies. At its worst, close reading is a retreat from the world outside the bounds of a book. At its best and most ethical, it is a process that ultimately transcends the specificities and formalities of any given work, as well as the finite parameters of the page, reaching outward in multiple directions to arrive at some broader challenge, lesson, or multiple directives. As the current director of the Carter G. Woodson Institute, I endeavor to advance the belief of the scholar-historian for whom the Institute is named, Carter G. Woodson, who writes, "Real education means to inspire people to live more abundantly, to learn to begin life as they find it and make it better." As a student and teacher of African American studies, the broader lessons of my teaching inevitably concern the ways in which higher education, what we study in university classrooms, must be aligned with the realities of social struggle and the civic responsibilities of living in a democracy. It may help my case that, unlike Emerson, I have not chosen so vexatious a topic as institutional religion, nor am I, like him, admonishing you to go it alone, to refuse the good models, to reject out of hand the mind of the past. On the contrary, I invite you to walk with me this morning as I turn to a few of the good, though not perfect, models exemplified by many minds of the past. Some of the names I reference will be familiar to you, others maybe not. But because this talk resembles aspects of a classroom lecture, to save us time this morning, let me pause to note that I will post the speech next week on the website of the Carter G. Woodson Institute, along with a detailed bibliography of references, part of your assignment. Think of me as addressing you by appealing to the minds of the past that have influenced me. Think of my advice as coming largely through their words and constituting a part of your textual inheritance. In answering for myself the question that had caused me such initial distress, what can I say? I ultimately decided to embrace once more the wisdom of Audre Lorde. "There are no new ideas," she reminds us, "just new ways of giving those ideas we cherish breath and power in our own living." Joseph Brodsky, the Russian poet and essayist, chimed in with reinforcement from his perspective as poet writing public addresses. "No matter what a poet may plan to say at the moment of the speech, he always knows he inherits the subject." Brodsky continues, "The great literature of the past humbles me, not only through its quality, but through its topical precedence as well." I would like to translate precedence here to mean priority, including but not reducible to temporality. I also mean priority in the sense of urgency, of what demands our attention now. What then, from among this vast textual inheritance, would work best for this occasion? and what are its implications for our times. Time became my guide. Stage two, choosing a text for the times. Of the numerous topics around which I have organized my research and oriented my courses over the decades of my career, since 2013, the year most of you matriculated to this university, at least the undergraduates, I have been at work on an initiative that I term 50 over 5, remembering the modern movement for civil rights. Multifaceted in scope, the initiative has included a sequence of courses, each focused on a pivotal year in a 5-year trajectory from 1963 to 1968. I have been partly inspired by the fact that since 2013, we have witnessed a series of 50th anniversaries, hence 50 over 5, marking major milestones in the modern civil rights movement, which will culminate in 2018. Although historians have rightly challenged and complicated this way of framing the movement, which many prefer to call the long Black freedom struggle, extending centuries back, at least in the popular imagination, the stretch of years between 2013 and 2018 constitute the quintessence of the modern era of the movement, an era meriting these anniversary celebrations. And so many in the nation have been observing them, beginning with the 1963 March on Washington for Jobs and Freedom, the 1964 Civil Rights Act, Freedom Summer, the 1965 Voting Rights Act, the 1966 Watts Uprising, the birth of the Chicago Freedom Movement, and the Supreme Court's Bond versus Floyd decision, which ruled that the Georgia House of Representatives had denied Julian Bond his freedom of speech when it refused to seat him in the legislature to which he had been duly elected. This is, of course, an abbreviated listing. Now we have arrived at 1967, which brought its own milestones. Julian Bond took his seat in the 136th District of Georgia. The Poor People's Campaign was launched. Martin Luther King delivered Beyond Vietnam, a time to break silence from the pulpit of Riverside Church in New York City, and published his very last book, Where Do We Go From Here? Chaos or Community. This is our text for this morning, around which others will revolve as I deliver my abbreviated lesson, in which is contained your next assignment, a series of implicit and explicit challenges to you just before you take your leaves from these very hallowed grounds. Like many lessons, this one will necessarily involve repetition and review. Things you've heard before and things you haven't. It will involve as well an attempt to find in the texts of Martin Luther King and many of his contemporaries and as well as his ancestors, directions for our times. In other words, I have not selected this text merely because of the convenience and coincidence of the calendar, nor for the poetic symmetry my training bids me notice. No, I have chosen it because 50 years since its publication, its words still resonate, its lessons still teach, its injunctions still call us forth to take up the responsibilities of citizenship, to make real the promises of democracy, as King put the matter in his far more famous speech, I Have a Dream. Stage three, reading the text. By the time King came to publish Where Do We Go From Here, he had reached the grim conclusion that legal structures had in practice proved neither structures nor law. He went on to assert the recording of the law in itself is treated as the reality of reform, despite the gulf between the laws and their enforcement. By 1967, he had reached the equally grim conclusion that each step forward in this long freedom struggle accents an ever-present tendency to backlash, And though not standing at that moment in 1967, exactly where he was when he accepted the place of leadership for which a community had prepared and claimed him, way back there in Montgomery in 1955, the pace of progress in the interim had been sluggish indeed. I find it significant that unlike the titles of his other books, Where Do We Go From Here? Takes the form of a question, a simple question. And in the space of six simple monosyllabic words, King gestures toward an answer, though one which is far from simple. There is subtle movement implied in the title from where at the beginning, here at the end, before we arrive at the subtitle, Chaos or Community. There in the middle of these six deceptively simple words sits we. I will come back to we, as well as to the subtitle, in a few moments. In the larger economy of the book, the first chapter of which is titled, Where Are We? King makes one point crystal clear. Before we can know where we go from here, we must know where we are right now. We must take the pulse of the times. We are here in Charlottesville, Virginia, where it pains me to acknowledge that we, like so many communities, especially university communities, are living through tense and contentious times, which we will weather. Many colleges and universities are openly confronting their origins in and profits from the institution of slavery, and are simultaneously confronting their legacies, the history of the Confederate past, and most especially the signs and symbols that glorify the Confederacy. Citizens of New Orleans have had to work in camouflage as they have dismantled over the last few weeks Confederate statuary, the last of which came down just this week. Citizens of Charlottesville have spent better than the last year diving with both feet into this controversy, engaging it in open and often furious but ultimately constructive debate. Last week on Saturday evening, May 13th, our town came literally face to face with this history in the form of those who would preserve it, along with the intolerance, racism, and white supremacy it represents. None of this is new, and far more urgent matters beg for our attention. Matters King delineated exhaustively in Where Do We Go From Here? We are at a moment that bears unsettling resemblance to the time of King's time. In that book, and in the numerous speeches he delivered well before its publication, King denounced what he termed the unspeakable horrors of police brutality, the interrelated evils of racism, poverty, militarism, materialism, the deplorable state of public education, high rates of black imprisonment, joblessness, lower life expectancies, and many other intractable disparities. We witness such disparities at the same time we are repeatedly enjoined to turn the page, to recognize that we as a country are now living in a post-civil rights, post-racial, post-political moment. But King demands that we complicate this progressivist narrative in order to refocus our attention on the where, the here, and the now. Stage four, respecting time. In rereading many of King's speeches and sermons for this occasion, I am struck by how often he positions himself in the here and now, invoking alongside the rhetorical flourishes, lofty metaphors, and eloquent passages that define his oratory, those most mundane words, here, now, locating and orienting us in space and time. Indeed, in the December 1955 speech that launched his career as a social justice warrior, King began, "We are here. We are here this evening for serious business. We are here because first and foremost, we are American citizens. We are here because of our love of democracy. There in that speech delivered at the Holt Street Baptist Church in Montgomery, Alabama, King urged on his audience his view that in order for democracy to be transformed from thin paper to thick action, his words, injustice and inequality must be uprooted wherever they flourished. With this speech in 1955, King planted the seed that would ripen into his least well-known, certainly his least celebrated, least popular speech against the Vietnam War in 1967. In that speech, titled A Time to Break Silence, delivered at Riverside Church, roughly 1 year to the day before his 1968 assassination, King knew that the times called for an end to silence regarding the Vietnam War. He knew that his dissent would embolden his enemies and estrange his friends and allies, most notably Lyndon Johnson, as well as the leadership of the NAACP. But he explained his decision to dedicate himself to the cause of peace, a dedication fully compatible with the broader cause of social justice. In answering his critics, King argued, ultimately, a genuine leader is not a center for consensus, but a molder of consensus. And on some positions, cowardice asks the question, is it safe? Experience asks, is it politic? Vanity asks, is it popular? But conscience asks the question, is it right? And there comes a time when one must take a position that is neither safe, nor politic, nor popular, but he must take it because conscience tells him it is right. And that is where I find myself. In connecting these two points, Montgomery and New York, King spoke to his understanding of the march, that the march of progress is anything but strictly linear. This reality required what he and his contemporary Ella Baker both understood, the importance of developing a long-range view of political struggle. As I move to complete this lesson, let me return to the subtitle of Where Do We Go From Here? Chaos or Community. King lays the groundwork for a provisional answer in the final chapter of this book titled The World House. The World House. There, King began by referencing the notes of a famous novelist containing a list of possible plots for future stories. The most prominent on the list, King noted, was this. A widely separated family inherits a house in which they have to live together. He goes on to say, this is a great new problem of mankind. We have inherited a large house, a great world house, in which we have to live together, black and white, Easterner and Westerner, Gentile and Jew, Catholic and Protestant, Muslim and Hindu, a family unduly separated in ideas, culture, and interests, who, because we can never again live apart, must learn somehow to live with each other in peace. The answer then to the question, chaos or community, could not be clearer. Unless we learn to live in community, to cultivate the ethics of the we, chaos will ensue. To repeat, by 1967, with the much vaunted victories of the movement behind him, King knew, as he had always known, that far greater challenges lay ahead, but they would not be his alone to solve. He knew that it was they, the people, who had begun the struggle of which he was now the symbol and leader. And it was they who had been doing and would continue to do this work. By 1967, King's leadership was being fiercely tested by the youth, who questioning and often rejecting the strategies of his organization, the Southern Christian Leadership Council, had begun to take this social revolution in different directions. Some, especially the students who formed the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, or SNCC, guided and encouraged by Ella Baker. Baker had long insisted that strong people don't need strong leaders, and that organizations don't necessarily make movements. Explaining her own orientation as an activist and organizer, Baker noted, "I was never working for an organization. I always tried to work for a cause, and that cause was bigger than any organization." Baker was certainly right. Though youth turned to her for guidance and direction, they and she were well aware that youth must find for themselves the directions their work would take. They must find their own where, their own here. My late and still lamented colleague, Julian Bond, was one such person. He gives an account of how he came to join with his fellow students at Morehouse College from the very perch of a cafe in Atlanta, Georgia. Reading about the Greensboro, North Carolina sit-ins in a newspaper, his colleague Lenny King says, "Have you seen this? Do you think it could happen here?" Bunn answered, "I know it could happen here. The rest is history." Bond was then about the same age as many of you are who sit before me. I am encouraged by the exemplary work many of you are doing, not just on these grounds, but throughout Charlottesville and beyond, working on the Living Wage campaign, assisting refugees, canvassing on behalf of affordable housing. Our students, you are all making us proud and making it abundantly clear that you refuse to adjust to injustice, a refusal that links you in a big, wide, growing we of other youth across this nation who have committed themselves to an ethic of service and a spirit of reform. I give you one of your last assignments. Join them. As I take my seat this morning, let me recap this lesson's central points. Discover what you are afraid to say and why. Trust the process of your doing. Honor questions. Find your own here. Believe with King in the fierce urgency of now. I would also like to leave you with a clutch of my hopes for you. May you find a cause that fires you. Excuse me, I have lost the page of my speech. Okay, here we are. May you find a cause that fires you. May you find work that gives you meaning. May you find a career that is rewarding. May you choose a life worth living. And may each and every one of you be claimed. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor McDowell. And now the chair of the University of Virginia Alumni Association Board of Managers.
First of all, congratulations to the class of 2017. Since your degrees will soon be conferred, on behalf of the Alumni Association of the University of Virginia, it is my privilege and my great honor to welcome you to our ranks. Each of you will leave grounds today with tremendous memories. Rector Goodwin remembered where he was on his graduation day. You all will remember this day. You will remember singing the good old song in Scott Stadium, the honor system, and you'll remember our cultural landmarks, the corner, the beautiful rotunda, and this wonderful lawn. But I'd like to add one more cultural institution to your memory. It's Alumni Hall, that big white building on Emmett Street, which I promise to you will become your forever home here in Charlottesville. Some of you will immediately gravitate to the many offerings that the Alumni Association provides. We will certainly see you next fall at a Young Alumni Weekends. Last year, 3,500 young alumni came back, and I'm certain the class of 2017 will break that mark. You will happily attend your 5-year, 10-year, or 20-year Alumni Association-sponsored class reunions, and you will smartly utilize the Alumni Association's alumni career services to help plan your career or to help you find your dream job. But some of you will leave Charlottesville this week, go off to your next city, begin work and life, and before you know it, years will have passed without you having the chance or maybe even the inclination to check back with your alma mater. Regardless of which of these two paths you take, I want to assure you that your Alumni Association will be here for you always. Think of the Alumni Association as the voice of the alumni and the home for the alumni. We'll keep you informed about what's happening here on the grounds and serve as a repository for your thoughts on important issues. We are your forever home here in Charlottesville, whether we see you every year or whether decades pass before we see you again. The Alumni Association will always welcome you with open arms and with a hearty wahoo. So please make the Alumni Hall your first stop at reunions, your starting point when you decide to improve your career skills, and your advisor many years from now when you have children of your own who are contemplating attending the university. Today you graduate, but your relationship with the University of Virginia is just beginning. I invite all of you, our newest alumni, to use Alumni Hall as your voice and your home at every stage of your life. So congratulations on your accomplishments and best wishes for your future.
The President of the University.
Thank you, Mr. Jarvis. The university is fortunate to have many loyal alumni who are dedicated to their alma mater. Those of you who graduate today have benefited from the generosity of alumni, parents, and friends who make gifts to the university to improve the quality of life and learning here. Because of their generosity in recent years, we have wonderful new buildings such as the South Lawn, Bavaro Hall, Rice Hall, Lacey Hall, Ruffin Hall, the Ruth Kaplan Theater, and others. We have wonderful programs such as the College Arts Scholars, the Contemplative Sciences Center, and the Cavalier Marching Band. Loyal donors have helped to make all of this possible in recent years, and you yourselves have joined this tradition of giving through your class gift with a 53% participation rate from the fourth year class. Nearly 2,000 members of the fourth year class contributed gifts totaling more than $316,000. In the College of Arts and Sciences, more than 1,000 students participated in the campaign. Thank you all for the generosity you have demonstrated even before you have left the grounds. The Raven Society is the oldest and most prestigious university organization. It recognizes scholarship and other contributions to life here. With us today is one newly elected alumni member of the Raven Society, and you just heard from him, Bill Jarvis. And we also have an alumna receiving a Raven Award, Victoria Harker. Bill and Victoria, would you please stand and let us applaud you? So now I'd like to share some observations about our graduating students. There are profiles of some of these students that have appeared on the university website and in the Cavalier Daily. They highlight students working in disciplines as diverse as biology, economics, politics, chemistry, religious studies, music, and sociology. Their stories are remarkable, and I encourage you to read them. But every student here today has his or her own story of hard work and achievement. We celebrate your stories as well. All of today's graduates claim a special distinction. By choosing to study the arts and sciences, whether in the college or in the graduate school, you have affirmed the truth that education in the liberal arts remains vital and valuable in the 21st century. A broad education in the arts, sciences, social sciences, and humanities teaches us so many things. To be critical thinkers, to be perceptive of the world around us, to write with clarity and force, and to integrate multiple perspectives before arriving at conclusions. These broad skills, as much as any specialized technical skill, are fundamental to the work of solving the complex 21st century global problems. You've prepared yourself for that work by choosing the rigorous curriculum in arts and sciences. Some of today's graduates enjoy another distinction because they worked especially hard to complete their degrees early. 100 graduates from the College of Arts and Sciences have earned their baccalaureate degrees in 3 years, and 6 more college students did so in only 2 years. In recognition of their effort, and as a symbol of their achievement, these students are wearing orange stoles today. I invite those students wearing orange stoles to stand, please. I congratulate you on your accomplishment, and I welcome you to the Order of the Orange Sash. Some of this weekend's graduates have another particular distinction. More than 400 students of this class are the first members of their families to graduate from college. We salute their commitment to education and their diligence in earning their degrees, and let us also give them a hand. And we can't ignore the extraordinary numbers of awards and dignities that have been earned by members of this class. Among the students graduating from the college today, we have 3 Fulbright scholars. Two Rhodes scholars. Two Marshall scholars. Two Rotary Global Grant recipients. One recipient of an Erdogan Scholarship, which brings the world's top graduate students in the humanities to Oxford to study. and one recipient of a MENAR Fellowship, which brings top graduates of American universities to work in organizations in the Middle East and North Africa. Congratulations to all of you. Among today's graduates, 41 were in the Jefferson Public Citizens Program to combine research and service. 39 received Harrison Undergraduate Research Awards. 5 received Double WHO research grants to allow undergraduate and graduate students to work together on research. 8 students received community-based undergraduate research grants, and 3 received university awards for projects in the arts. And this graduating class has lived and learned at a truly global university. This weekend, nearly 1,100 of our graduating students came to UVA from other countries, bringing an international perspective and enriching life for all of us. And many of our American students represented UVA in the world beyond the grounds. 32% of this weekend's graduating students participated in some form of education or research abroad. Today's graduates have a wide variety of post-graduation plans, whether they enter the workforce, engage in service, or pursue further education. Yesterday, we commissioned new second lieutenants and ensigns in the United States Armed Services. Degree candidates from the graduate school have accepted professorships and postdoctoral appointments at many great institutions, including Princeton, UCLA, and the University of California, Berkeley. And others of you are launching startup companies and pursuing other business opportunities. And whatever your futures hold, you are now prepared to provide vision and leadership at every level of the careers and communities you enter as you leave this place. All of today's degree candidates are listed in your program, including those who completed the requirements for degrees in December or last August. For the candidates from the College of Graduate School of Arts and Sciences, we will award 3,076 total degrees, including 2,604 bachelors, 263 masters, and 209 PhDs. Now, under the authority vested in the general faculty and by it delegated to me, I will award the degrees. The Dean of the College and Graduate School of Arts and Sciences will present the candidates for degrees. Immediately after these exercises, department graduation ceremonies will take place around the grounds. The locations are listed in the finals program.
The Executive Vice President and Provost of the University.
I call upon Ian Bochum, the Dean of the College and Graduate School of Arts and Sciences, to present the candidates for degrees.
The candidates for the degree of Doctor of Philosophy will please rise and remain standing. Madam President, as Dean of the College and Graduate School of Arts and Sciences, I have the honor to present these candidates who have fulfilled the requirements for the degree of Doctor of Philosophy.
I confer upon you the degree of Doctor of Philosophy with all the rights and privileges thereunto belonging. I welcome you to the ancient and universal company of scholars.
The Doctors of Philosophy will please be seated.
To welcome to the ancient and universal company of scholars, my daughter-in-law, Natasha Michaels, PhD.
The candidates for the degrees of Master of Arts, Master of Arts in Physics Education, Master of Public Health, and Master of Science will please rise and remain standing. Madam President, as Dean of the College and Graduate School of Arts and Sciences, I have the honor to present these candidates who have fulfilled the requirements for the degree of Master of Arts, Master of Arts in Physics Education, Master of Public Health, or Master of Science.
I confer upon you the appropriate master's degree with all the rights and privileges thereunto belonging. I charge you to apply the knowledge you have gained in ways that advance social good and promote humane values.
The Master of Arts, Master of Arts in Physics Education, Masters of Public Health, and Masters of Science will please be seated. The candidates for the degrees of Bachelor of Arts or Bachelor of Science in the College of Arts and Sciences will please rise and remain standing. Madam President, as Dean of the College Graduate School of Arts and Sciences, I have the honor to present these candidates who have fulfilled the requirements for the degree of Bachelor of Arts or Bachelor of Science in Arts and Sciences.
I confer upon you the degree of Bachelor of Arts or Bachelor of Science with all the rights and privileges thereunto belonging, and welcome you to the Fellowship of Educated Men and Women. I charge you. I charge you to pursue truth in all of your endeavors and to apply the principles of rigorous inquiry and civil discourse in your professions, in your lives as public citizens, and in your engagement with the cultures in which you will live.
The Bachelors of Arts and Bachelors of Science will please be seated.
And now a few closing words for today's graduating students. Each graduate today is receiving a booklet of Thomas Jefferson's writings about the three creations for which he wished to be remembered: the Virginia Statute for Religious Freedom, the American Declaration of Independence, and the University of Virginia. A gift from the Alumni Association, this booklet is meant to be a memento of these years when you encountered a complex figure who believed that education has the power to improve lives. In the course of your lives, you will belong to other communities and cultures. Each will have its own values and customs. I hope you take with you, as you leave here, the values that have distinguished you as a student at the University of Virginia. Most of us experience times in our lives when it might be easiest to follow the path of self-interest, to keep quiet when truth is obscured, to avoid participating in the fray, to cling to comfortable ideas even when presented with challenging facts. In these times, you may be tempted to compromise your values, to argue the easy point rather than the valid point, to follow blindly rather than to lead boldly. At these times, I urge you to reread this booklet. Recall that each of Jefferson's creations came as a result of perseverance, sacrifice, and deep commitment to enduring values during the turmoil of America's founding. As you go forward today, cultivate in yourselves the tenacity to hold elected officials, but yourselves as well, to strict account. Engage in the political process that builds durable and systematic change when change is due. Work as educated citizens to protect freedom, your own personal freedom, and the freedom of the others who depend upon you. Contribute to the work that is necessary to sustain a democracy. And in all that you do, commit yourselves and your fortunes to the common good. These are our fondest hopes for you. Godspeed and best wishes as you go.
Department ceremonies will begin after graduates and their guests have ample time to reach their ceremony sites. If your ceremony is scheduled to begin at 1 p.m. or sooner, please proceed directly to your ceremony venue. And now, graduates, would you please stand for the singing of the good old song?